أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I begin in the name of the Almighty God, the Compassionate, the Merciful, the One who has created everything in utmost perfection. And may the peace and blessings of the Almighty God be upon His pure and beloved Messenger, the peak of His creation, the Holy Prophet Muhammad. Peace be upon him and his immaculate progeny of the Ahlul-Bait, especially the leader of our time, the awaited Savior, Al-Imam Al-Mahdi, Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Farajah. May Allah hasten his reappearance and make us all amongst his sincere and dedicated servants. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala states in the Holy Quran, Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُمْ عَذَابًا مُهِينًا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Illuminate your hearts and minds with a very loud salawat. اللهم صل على محمد. As we continue our journey into the first general ziyarah of Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam, we come across this passage in which Al-Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam declares his stance towards those who killed Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam. In this passage, the Imam alayhi salam teaches us to say, لُعِنَتْ أُمَّةٌ قَتَلَتْكُمْ وَأُمَّةٌ خَالَفَتْكُمْ وَأُمَّةٌ جَحَدَتْ وِلَايَتَكُمْ وَأُمَّةٌ ظَاهَرَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي جَعَلَ النَّارَ مَثْوَاهُمْ وَبِئْسَ وِرْدُ الْوَارِدِينَ. In this passage, the Imam alayhi salam is invoking the curse and the la'na of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on those who killed Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam, those who disobeyed the Imam alayhi salam, those who conspired against the Imam alayhi salam, those who did not support the Imam alayhi salam. وَأُمَّةٌ شَهِدَتْ وَلَمْ تَسْتَشْهِدْ. They were present there, but they made no effort to defend you, O Aba Abdullah. In this important passage in the ziyarah, we come across a very common theme that you find in most of the ziyaras of Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam. There is an emphasis on cursing the enemies of Abi Abdullah Al-Hussein. The issue of cursing the enemies of the Imam, the killers of the Imam, those who oppress the Ahlul Bayt, is without a doubt a very controversial issue. It's a subject that is hotly contested in our societies, in our communities, even amongst our scholars in the seminary circles. For example, you go to most of our communities and you will find that every once in a while there is a controversy because of Ziyarat Ashura, for example, because it contains passages where it curses the enemies of Ahlul Bayt. For example, the four enemies of the Ahlul Bayt are cursed in Ziyarat Ashura. There is tension in our communities. There is also tension between our school of thought and other schools of thought. This is an area that generates a lot of tension between the schools of thought, because many of those schools of thought, they attack us, the followers of Ahlul Bayt. They tell us we are not true Muslims because we curse certain individuals, certain companions, or those who killed Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam, and some of them were companions to the Prophet. This is a very controversial subject. And the ziyarah of Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam places a big importance, huge significance on the issue of cursing the killers of the Imam alayhi salam and all those who oppressed the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. Therefore, in this evening, let us analyze and examine the issue of sending one's curse, invoking the la'an of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the evildoers, on the enemies of Ahlul Bayt. Number one, what is the Quranic basis for us? Such an important topic. What does the Quran have to say about it? Does it lay a foundation for us? Does it serve as a basis for cursing the enemies of God and the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt? Number two, what can we draw from the practice and the seerah of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and his rightful successor, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, in this regard? Number three, how are the verses in the Holy Quran which speak of cursing applicable to the killers of Al-Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam? Number four, what is the benefit of cursing? What good does it do? What benefits does it offer us? What is the philosophy behind invoking the la'an of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the enemies of Ahlul Bayt? Number five, why is it that our brothers from the Ahlul Sunnah, they reject the concept of la'an when it comes to our Islamic history? They tell us, forget what happened after the Prophet during the time of Bani Umayyah, during the time of Bani al-Abbas, let's not curse anyone. Why? And number six, finally, are there any social dimensions or lessons that we can learn from the topic of la'an? Let's begin with the Holy Quran. What is the stance of the Holy Quran when it comes to cursing the evildoers and the enemies of God and Ahlul Bayt? Before we analyze some verses of the Holy Quran, it is very important for us to make a distinction between cursing and between swearing. Because you find that the problem is many of us are confused. We mix between the two. Cursing is one thing, swearing is another thing. Swearing is when you use inappropriate language, profanity, highly offensive language against someone. This is sab or swearing. But la'na or cursing has a different meaning, and many people are unaware of the meaning of la'na. And that's why you see this tension, because they are unaware of its original meaning. In the Arabic language, the meaning of cursing or la'na is exactly the opposite or the antonym of rahmah. When you say, oh Allah, irham waliday, have mercy on my parents, what does that mean? You're making a prayer, oh God, have mercy on my parents, bless them, give them blessings, protect them. If they have passed away, forgive them. This all falls under the category of rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The opposite of rahmah is the word la'na. The word la'na means, oh Allah, deny so-and-so person. For example, deny the killer of Al-Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Deny the evildoers from your mercy. These people do not deserve your mercy, oh Allah, because of their evil actions. So I am asking you, oh Allah, deny them your mercy. That's the meaning of la'na. It doesn't mean that you're cussing at someone. It doesn't mean that you're using profane language. We must make this very important distinction. What we find in the Holy Quran is the concept of cursing, not the concept of swearing or using profane language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never uses anything inappropriate. All of the verses of the Holy Quran are polite. Now there are some that will argue with you and tell you, no, we see some very highly offensive language in the Holy Quran. We see swearing or cussing in the Holy Quran. And you ask them, where are those verses? For example, they will use a couple of examples, a few more. Let's share a couple of examples. You are told that one verse in the Holy Quran which swears at other people is this verse which we always hear on Friday, on a day like tomorrow in Salatul Jum'ah. What do we say? In one of the verses of Surah Al-Jum'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةَ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُوا أَسْفَارَ. The likeness of those who have given the, who have been given the Torah, the Old Testament, but they did not comprehend it, they did not practice it, their likeness is the likeness of a donkey which carries books on its back. So the argument of these people is that, look, you have offensive language in the Quran. This is swearing. Allah is calling them donkeys. He's swearing at them. This is one verse. But when you analyze this verse, you realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not using inappropriate language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing to us their state. Allah is telling us, look, I've given you a book, and that's the Torah. I have revealed this book to you, so you benefit from this book. So you read it, you analyze it, you ponder on it. What's the point of carrying the Torah and saying we're the chosen people, we have a book from God, and you don't practice it? This is like a donkey which carries books on its back. Does a donkey benefit? A donkey could carry 100 books on its back. What's the point of that? Is its knowledge going to increase? Is this donkey going to act better? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is simply describing to us their action. Allah is not swearing at them. And Allah, note, He does not say they're donkeys. Allah is saying their actions are like the actions of a donkey. Allah is simply giving us a parable. And by the way, this verse is not only applicable to those who were given the Torah. This verse is applicable today to millions of Muslims. They have the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Holy Quran. They recite it like parrots, not knowing what it means. You go to some communities around the world. Go to Riyadh, go to Mecca, go to some of these holy places. And you will see some Muslims, they can recite the Quran better than you can ever do in your life. And they will memorize every verse in it. But they have no clue what they're reciting. And when you examine their entire life, you see their life is based on disobeying the Quran. What good is this Quran doing to you? One day Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, along with his companion Kumail, they were passing by when Kumail heard this beautiful recitation. A man was reciting the Quran beautifully. Kumail was, you know, very pleased to hear that. He was interested in this man. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam told him, oh Kumail, don't look at the outside appearance. Yes, this person may be reciting the Quran beautifully, but this person is an enemy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kumail was confused. How is that possible? The Imam told him, I'll show you one day. The days go by and the battle of Nahrawan comes. When the Imam was fighting the Khawarij, the evil ones who came out to fight him. When the Imam alayhi salam, when one of those enemies came forward to fight the Imam struck him and he killed him. He fell on the ground. As they were passing by with Kumail, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam tells Kumail, Kumail, look at this dead person. Do you recognize him? Kumail looks at him. He doesn't really know who he is. The Imam tells him, remember so-and-so day we were passing by and you heard the beautiful recitation of someone who recited the Quran? He's like, yes, I remember that day. He's like, this is him. What good did his Quran do to him? It only took him further away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse is very applicable today. These ISIS people, many of them read the Quran better than many of us can. Fluent Arabic. Very fluent. They memorize many verses of the Quran, but they're murdering left and right. They're like donkeys who carry books on their backs, not knowing what it means. So this is not profane language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is simply describing them. Another verse in the Holy Quran is you have that verse which was revealed to let Muslims know about a very pious man who was initially pious and then he went astray. Bal'am ibn Ba'ura. كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ إِن تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكُهُ يَلْهَثْ. Allah is describing this man. He's like, he is like a dog. Whether you attack him, he will loll out his tongue. Or if you leave him, he will loll out his tongue. In other words, this is an Arabic expression which means no matter how much you try to guide him, you be good to him, you give him guidance, he will reject. You leave him, he will reject. Anything you do with this person, he will continue rejecting. Again, this verse is not using profane language. It's not swearing at that person. Allah is describing his state. The dog has certain qualities. You know, sometimes animals have good qualities. One of the good qualities of a dog is to be loyal. Allah is referring to this quality of a dog, that whether you attack it, whether you leave it, it will loll out its tongue. This is the state of this man who is away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who rejects his hidayah. So this is in no way using profane language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not swearing. Therefore, what we have in the Holy Quran is cursing the enemies of God, not swearing at them. Swearing is inappropriate. The Quran does not use inappropriate language. Now, those who have doubts about swearing, or those who reject this ziyarah, or this hadith, or that hadith, because it curses the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your number one source is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See what the Holy Quran says when it comes to the issue of swearing. In the Holy Quran, there are 37 verses that explicitly mention the la'an of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 37 verses. I tell you, there are many important topics in the religion of Islam that you don't have 37 verses dedicated to them, discussing them. Therefore, this, number one, brings to our attention that this is something very important. It's part and parcel of the Holy Quran. You know, you only need one verse in the Holy Quran to validate anything. How about if you have 37 verses? Now, these 37 verses, we can divide them into 10 categories. We can generalize and categorize them into 10 categories. Number one, you have the verse in the Holy Quran in Surah Sad, verse 78, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curses the devil. This is a recurring verse in the Holy Quran, in which God's most avowed enemy, the shaytan, is being cursed. وَأَنَّ عَلَيْكَ لَعْنَتِي إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. My curse shall include you until the appointed day, until either day of judgment or the ظهور of Imam al-Mahdi عَجَّلَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فَرَجَهُ. اللهم صلي على محمد. That's one category of verses. A second category of verses that invoke the curse and the la'na of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon those who were introduced to the religion of Islam. They saw the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they willfully and deliberately rejected, stubbornly rejecting the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, you have in Surah Al-Baqarah, of
Obey the prophets who used to harass them, they were cursed on